Beloved, Baba used to come to Bindra House during the summer vacation, and along with them, Francis Brabazon also used to come. And I had just got my first baby, whom beloved Baba named Mera, baby Mera. And whenever Baba used to come in the late afternoons, between 1 and 2, Francis also used to come with the men Mandli. And there was a nice big dining table on which Baba always wanted me to put the baby on the table on a nice big towel and some baby napkins, a bottle of milk, a bottle of water, and a rattler. And Baba would play with the baby. And because it used to be very hot, so what Erich's mother used to do is make a big pot of sherbet, lemon sherbet, for everybody who came from the sun could have nice cold drink. One day sherbet, and another day we would make buttermilk. And we would put the pot near on the table, and we would fill up the glasses. Baba would be given the glass. Baba would have few sips, and then he would dip his little finger in the glass and give his little finger to little baby Mera to suck. It went on and on. Then Baba would ask me to give the baby in his arms, and Baba would hold the baby and play with the baby. And all this Francis used to observe. And Baba used to take so much of interest in that little child that one fine day he really got fed up of watching Baba give so much of love to this little child. He said, he just spoke out spontaneously, "Oh, beloved Baba, I feel like dying to right now and be reborn so that you would play with me. I'm feeling very jealous of this baby." And Baba laughed. Baba says, "No, not now. You have a lot of my work to finish in Australia." And then Francis didn't say anything. He just kept quiet and watched Baba do whatever Baba wanted to do. And Baba used to, she was very little, just maybe when Baba came from Nagar, she was just 20 days old. What time Francis spoke that, I don't remember now. But in 3 months' time, sometime it happened. And then, when she was more than a month old, Baba said to Dr. Gavir, "I want you to prick her ears. We prick the baby's ears when they are very little so that it hurts less to them." And another thing is they don't pull their ears. When the children are big, the ear itches and they pull it, the thread, and play with it or something. So we all usually do when they are very little. So the ear was to be pricked. So Baba was holding the baby in the hand. Gower put mercury chrome's dot on the ear for the marking. And she told me to boil thread and needle, put the black thread into the needle and boil it for 20 minutes. And after that was done, it was sterile at home. And then I brought that dish for her. Baba said, "Let it cool it off, then Till then, he was holding the baby. And the very first prick she got, she yelled and started to cry and wriggle in Baba's arms. And Baba felt very much that the child is hurt so much. And then he says to Gauver, "Can't we do the second year tomorrow? Doctor says, "Baba, when child has one prick, tomorrow again it will be the same thing. So why not do it today?" Baba says, "Really today?" "Oh yes, Baba, it is a practice. We do it in one shot." And Baba says, "Okay." So then Baba changed the side of the head so that Dr. Gawe could put a second prick. And Baba said, "It's done." And it got over. And Naja was there because Baba's and Mandli's food used to go from Bindra house, ladies, Mandli's. And Baba had told me to cook for Francis. And I still remember Francis like cucumber cooked, stuffed sometimes with vegetation, sometimes with... Naja would make nice light mince, like a kebab or something. And we would take out the center of the cucumber and stuff it inside. And I had to do it on a light stove, not big fire, on a low stove. And we had to do cooking for Baba. And Baba's orders were when he would be there, I would make chutney for him every day. Any grinding had to be done, I should do. Not for everybody, but Baba's. Baba's curry or Baba's coconut to be grounded. So there was a nice stone grinding thing. That time we didn't have any mixies or any kind of machinery to do that job. And we used to do it with hands. And even before she was born, Baba had given me that job to do, that I must grind his chutney and help Naja to do cooking for Baba. The kitchen was very, very small. Manpur, myself, and Naja, we would work in the kitchen. And the caser, who just passed away on the 29th of August, at that time she was very young, and she would help us to pick up the pots and things. One day I was grinding Baba's chutney, sitting down on the floor with a nice big belly, and all of a sudden Baba came without warning. Otherwise he used to honk, and I was supposed to go and hold the umbrella for Baba so that he doesn't like to walk in the hot sun. But he came earlier, not in the afternoon, say maybe 8:39 after he went for his walk. Every day he used to go for walk near the race course or near the Pune club, wherever he felt like. And then he would have a nice ride and go back to Guru Prasad. That day Baba came and I was grinding. And he and Eraj both came and stood behind me. And Baba says, "Look at her, big belly, grinding." So Eraj whispered in Baba's ear, "Baba, I think she is going to produce a cook." And Baba laughed. And as soon as I heard Eraj's voice, I turned around and I saw beloved Baba standing behind me. And my hands were dirty. And I said, Jai Baba, Baba dear. And he says, he did like this, and went into the house. One day, Baba had come to Bindra house when Erich's mother, Gaimai, another aunt of mine, Gula Masi, and Banu Masi. Banu Masi is Sam's mother. Their job was to make chapatis and bhakris, millet chapatis, for everybody. And all of a sudden, Baba arrived while they were doing. And Erich's brother, Mervan, also used to help in making them, because we had to do it for many people. And all the Mandlis were young, so they were good eaters. And all of Baba just felt like making a chapati. So he tells Gaimai, give me a ball of dough, wheat dough, and the rolling pin and that little wooden stool-like thing. And he started to make chapati. But if you don't have a practice of doing that, you can't make a round chapati. Baba would try to make this way, that way. The dough is so soft. It keeps making different shapes as you put the pressure on that pin. And Baba said, I never knew that making chapati is such a hard work. I made the whole universe, but I never knew that it was so difficult to make a chapati. And he made it like a big map, all crooked every point. And Erich's mother said, Baba, Baba, wait, let me break it and make it. Baba says, don't ever break my chapati. Cook it the way it is. And then Baba told Mervan to go and get a plate. And he ate his own chapati. You know, all these little memories. I usually don't read any books. But I just sit and start thinking of old days. And it just rolls in front of my eye like a movie. And Sam and Mervan and even Erich used to say, why don't you read books? But I said, I had not studied in English medium. So, till my children were born, I was not able to read anything. I was not even able to say a sentence properly. Only things that in Marathi school were taught. Yes, thank you, good morning, good afternoon, good night. And teachers themselves did not know good English. And when I was studying, it used to be the freedom fighters' time. So everybody wanted to avoid learning English. That spirit was there, you see. And we had learned in Marathi medium from childhood, so it was very easy to pick up anything in that language. No problem. But I wanted to learn English. So when my children started going to school from kindergarten, I decided this is the time I must learn with them. And then in India, your children get a lot of homework to do at home. So I used to sit with them, and they used to be my teacher, and I used to be their student. That way we can get closer to the children, and they love being the teacher. It was like a game. And what I can speak and read and write today is thanks to them. And Baba used to come and play with them After nearly 2.5 to 3 years, little Dolly was born. And Baba also used to come to see her. She was born on the 31st of May. So Baba was already in Pune, in Guru Prasad. And Baba used to come. Baba named her Dolly. And he said to Naja, "Today your mother is reborn, is Pendu's mother." Like that, Baba said for baby Mehra, that Erich's sister, no, Jal Kerawala is reborn. Like that, sometimes Baba used to get into that mood and he used to say things. But Baba alone knows. We are nobody to judge. What he says is in his language. And Baba, and once Sam was on leave and Baba was also in Pune, my duty was, as soon as Baba's car rolled in, I would run with the umbrella for Baba. And Baba would open the door, I would hold the umbrella and bring him inside and give my hand to Baba to come in. And Baba would walk in. One day, Sam was nearby, so Baba said to me, "You hold the umbrella, but let him come. I want to hold his hand and walk up." And Baba held his hand and put the pressure. Sam did not know how to keep the hand tight. So he just went down. Baba says, "You are no good. You are no good. Look at Roshan." And Baba said, "No, no, you go away, go away." And he held my hand and he walked up. And sometimes it used to be so nice, so nice. So when baby Mehra was little, and that year there was a very bumper crop of mangoes. So all the Baba people who came from the south would bring basket full of mangoes from their land. And lot of mangoes used to come, very, very sweet mangoes. And Baba's Rano Geli loved mangoes. So she would eat mangoes for breakfast, lunch and dinner. And she was not used to eating so much of mango. So she became sick. My Mehra was also sick from the hospital itself. She had picked up some virus on the stomach. Some nurses must have not taken good care when they fed the milk or something. So anyway, she was ill with diarrhea, and now Rano was ill with diarrhea. And Rano became more and more serious. She was vomiting and she was having diarrhea. And Baba would come every day to see us. So Erich's father, Papa Jasawala, goes and pleads Baba, "Baba, do whatever you can, but don't let that American lady die in my house. It will be a big problem for me." Because he was a trustee of Parsi Panchayat. So he thought there would be big talks in the town about a foreign lady dying in his household. Baba said to him, "You don't worry. Nothing is going to happen to her." That day Baba told Manpur, Erich's sister, "Go and squeeze out 2 sour limes, limbu, in a glass, and then add plenty of sugar to it and stir, 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 keep stirring till the sugar melts." And Baba went himself with Manpur to see Rano in her room. Dr. Gawar was also there. And Baba took the teaspoon and put few drops of the lemon on her tongue. And he said, "Swallow it very slowly so that it doesn't bring out. Hold it in." And she was able to do that. And from that point, her vomiting stopped. And then Baba told Manpur and Naja, who were taking care of Rano, that you must give her few drops every few minutes. And then later on, you add water to it when she feels like drinking, and give only a teaspoon, 2 teaspoons, 3 teaspoons, and gradually increase the intake. And the medicines that Dr. Gawar had prescribed were already going on. And she started getting little better by evening. And Papa Jasawala, who was hale and hearty, all of a sudden, and before going away, Baba gave orders to Mervan, Erich's brother, that he should go to bed, come what may. He should go to bed by 8 o'clock. He should be in bed. So we all had early dinner, and he went to bed. Papa also finished his dinner and he went to his room. After, say, half an hour or so, or maybe more, he started ringing the bell. We had given him a bell if he wanted anybody's attention to be drawn to come to his room if he needed something. So I went to his room, and Papa Jasawala was tossing and turning and rubbing his left side chest and saying to me, "Roshan, I can't breathe. There's pain in my chest." And I immediately recognized that it was an heart attack. He was sweating. So I went to Gai Mamma and Manpur. They were very nervous people. They were of no use in such conditions. So then the only person I could go was Mervan. And I went and told Mervan. Mervan and Papa wanted to go to the loo to relieve himself. So I said, "Mervan, I can't take him all by myself. I need help. And Mama and Manu are no use." So poor thing. He went to Baba's picture and said, "Baba, I have to break your order to help Roshan." And he came and helped me to take Papa to the loo. But I told Papa, "Don't lock the door. We are standing out. If you need anything, we'll be of help to you." He relieved himself, cleaned himself, and came out. And then he just couldn't stand or walk. So Mervan and I told him to put his hand around our shoulders, and we walked him to the bed. And I said, "Papa, you relax and lie down and take Baba's name. I'm rushing to the doctor to get the doctor." That time their family doctor was Dr. Kola in the next building or so. So I ran up. They used to stay on the first floor. But unfortunately, just 8 days before Papa had his heart attack, doctor himself had heart attack. I went to rush to the doctor's house, but his wife said he also had a heart attack. But fortunately, his son had just passed the exam and got the degree of doctorate. And he told his son to come and give us little help. And I brought him over, but he said, says to me, Roshan, I still do not have the certificate in my hands. If something worse happens, I can do nothing. You better go and... I'm going to the house, but you go to Dr. Fonseca, who is on the other side of the road. And she had a dispensary there. She had even a nurse. Both of them were friends. They were running a maternity home-like thing. Very small, few beds. So I rushed to the doctor, and doctor came up. And by the time doctor reached home, he had already passed away. And then she gave the certificate, and then Mehrwan did the needful. But sometimes before, when Baba used to come to play with baby Mehra, one day, Baba tells Rano jokingly that, why don't you die soon and come back as a baby so that I can play with you? But then in later days, she had really died. But Baba saved her for his own work. Yeah.
What do you mean, Roshan, she had really died?
Rano, who she was very serious, you see.
Of course, yes, yes.
She was very, very serious. She had nearly died.
Yes.
Yeah. It is Baba who saved her.
Yes. And Rano was also jealous of the attention Baba was paying to Mehra.
Yes.
Can you say that to the camera?
Huh?
Say that to the camera?
Sometimes she used to also, Rano Gailey also used to get jealous of baby Mehra. And so, jokingly, Baba said to Rano, you better die soon so that you can also be reborn. And I will play with you like this. And she looked, but Baba did not mean it. And when she really was about to die, Baba helped her to get revived. All these things, big things you may call it, but it used to be so natural with Baba. He used to make us forget that he was God. When he was with us, he was like a family member, you see. Sometimes Baba would tell us to bring our food along with his food to Guru Prasad. And the whole family would go to Guru Prasad. And they had a huge, huge dining table where more than 20 people could sit around. Baba would sit at the head of the table. On either side, Mehra and Mani would sit. And we would eat on the same table with Baba, Mehra, Mani, Nacha, Rano, everybody. Mehru, Khorshid, I remember. So, when little baby Mehra would be there, Baba would tell Mani to go one chair ahead, and he would ask me to sit next to him. When she started growing a little bigger, and she could eat a little bit, and then Baba would take from his food and put a morsel in her mouth and take out the marrow from the bone and give it to the little baby. Baba would tell me, you shouldn't do that. It is okay if I give her to eat. It is very heavy for the little child to digest. And all these things used to happen so naturally. We are so fortunate. Like Erich's mother used to say, Roshan, we have lived the golden life with beloved Baba. When you will tell Baba people, they will get jealous of you for spending so much of time. When I was very little and I stayed in Akbar Press in Ahmadnagar, that time also Baba would come home. And sometimes he would be in the mood, say, come on, let's all go and eat in the garden. We had a very, very lovely champa shade made by my uncle. And we used to spread satranjis on the crown, bring all the pots into the garden, put the pots around Baba. Baba would take it in his plate and then he would even give us the food. And we would all sit on the floor and enjoy eating the picnic-like thing. And we had a huge, huge swing at Akbar Press. Baba loved sitting on the swing. It was like a single bed. It was that big. It could hold nearly 7 to 10 people on it. And ladies would sit around and Baba would tell us to sing sometimes. And sometimes just have few swings and then he would say, let's go. And he would go away. Good old days with beloved Baba. Good old days. Baba has taken me from Pune to Nagar many a times. When I was studying in 50s, I used to study in Bombay, learning about garment designing. I had taken a diploma in that. So Meherji's car used to come from Bombay for beloved Baba. And Baba would tell me, if it was Saturday, Sunday, Baba would tell me to come in the car to Nagar. And then to meet my family in Nagar. And in the same car, Baba would take me back to Pune. And on the way, Mehra would always give some knickknacks to snack on. And Baba, like a little child, as soon as he would be out of the boundary of Ahmadnagar, he would open that box, put it on his lap. He would start nibbling and he would even pass it on to us, turn around and give us also the snacks. And then he would tell us to tell, have you ever stolen? Have you ever pimpered? I said, yes, Baba, many a times in childhood. My aunt, who was taking care of us, wouldn't give enough food. We were growing children, you see, growing children doing whole day work for my crippled brother and sister, and my aunt also, who was crippled. I hardly used to have time to play, no time, because everybody in the family were very elderly and I was the youngest. So I used to play with the boys. There were 13 boys in the family. But very little time I could get. So The aunt wouldn't feed us properly, and my brother and sister were also young children. They also used to feel very hungry. So they would tell me, get something for us. And at Akbar Press, we had to, it was a flat ground, and then we had to walk quite a distance to go to the loo. There were two big tin loos built. In those days, there were tin boxes in which all the dirt falls. And in the morning, early morning, a sweeper man comes with a bullock cart and a big tank, and he clears up the dirt from the box. So we had to go. There were two small steps which my brother and sisters with great difficulty would climb up and get in. But they always needed help to sit down and get up. Because of polio, they couldn't do these things easily. So I had to be there for them to help. So I used to steal chapati and some vegetable or something, or banana, put it under my inner pants, tuck it up, because we were made to wear very loose clothes, which were stitched by my aunt. And I would take it in the loo and we would have party. And I told that story to Baba, and Baba laughed. Really? Baba, I wouldn't tell lie, but I have never stolen any money. Because I always did not like to handle any money. Money was not my attraction. Food was. Sometimes I would go to my servant's house and bring the food from there and give them. The thing is, my sister and my brother's bed were just opposite to my aunt's bed. So if they were in a separate room, we could have them fed in the room. But since it was right in front of them, it was not correct to do that. Anyway, and they could not eat more food in one sitting because of their health. They used to frequently feel hungry. And Baba said to me, shall I tell your aunt not to do that? I said, Baba, if you did that, no, she will start locking up all the mash cupboards, and I won't even have the chance to do what I'm doing now. So Baba said, okay, okay, I'll take care of you. I never got caught stealing. Never got caught. And he was very, very compassionate to me. Very compassionate. And one day Baba asked me while going, do you miss your mother? I said, Baba, I don't even remember her face. How can I miss? You are my mother and father together. You give me so much of love. Baba called me close, gave me a good embrace. And the best part in life was we would look forward for beloved Baba to hold us and give a tight embrace. The love that flowed from his heart to us was so, so great. The pleasure that we got. And many a time some people asked me, how did you read Baba's gesture? I said, sometimes Erich read them and told us, but most of the time when Baba looked at us, his look was penetrating in our hearts and speaking to us We understood every gesture that he did. We did not have to learn to understand him. He was so loving, so loving. Yeah. I cannot explain how we felt inside. But when Baba became very ill and it was time for him to depart, the last time I met beloved Baba was on Dara and Amrit's wedding time. Baba had invited us to come for 4 days. So we all came and stayed in Akbar Press, and we would be driven in the bus from the house to Meherabad and back in the evening. We would spend the whole, nearly whole day there. And on the last day after the wedding, Baba allowed us to take his darshan. And when I went in the queue to Baba, Baba said to me, "Roshan, soon I will be gone. This body of mine is not going to last long." And
say that again, please. Say it again. Baba said.
Baba said, "This body of mine is not going to last very long. I have to now leave." So I looked at his face. And then he started telling me, "I have always enjoyed the clothes that you stitch for me and the food that you cooked. I have loved it. And then I bowed down and looked at his face. He said, "You won't be seeing me anymore." I said, "Baba, when you give us permission, we will come." So when Baba dropped his body, and every day we used to get Baba's news when he was very serious. Because Mehrwan had to arrange the doctor to go from Pune to Nagar for working on Baba. And then Baba said, Then Baba dropped his body. Everybody was very tensed. And we had to go. Merji took Gai Mai, Manpur, and Mehrwan in his car. But myself, two children, two servants, daddy, Banu Mama also had gone in the Merji's car. But we were left behind. Luckily, when the news came to the house, at that time, our Minu Bharucha, who used to take care of the electricity, he and his wife had come from Nasik to get Upasani Maharaj's car serviced. So the car was in Nagar, in Pune, and they had to take it back. So he said, "I will drive you to Nagar." So Merji went away quickly and we drove. And we thought the Baba's funeral will be tomorrow, you see. We did not know that the body will be kept for 7 days. So I had just packed, thrown one pair of clothes for the children and one pair of clothes for me to change. And some whatever money I had for the household use, I just dumped it in so it may come handy. And anyway, we were going to our own house, so we did not have to buy anything we would be fed at Akbar Press and all that. Arrangements were there at home. So, but we did not go to Akbar Press. We came straight from Pune to Meherabad. At that time, there was nothing except Padri's room and that big Baba's hall. Padri gave us some satranjis to spread on the floor and we slept on the ground. Most of the time we were at the samadhi with Baba, Mehra and Mandli. And then when people got the news, they started coming up. So there were no canteens, no carts on which you can even get a cup of tea. So that was not to be attended. Everybody wanted to be with Babas near the samadhi. Drinking water was provided in the big chettis opposite to Mansari's room. There were pots kept. That's all. But Baba gave me the thought. Baba never allowed anybody to go after seeing him hungry. So I said to Gai Mama, Mama, I am going into town and getting some food for everybody. So I went to Akbar Press and I told my aunt, make the servants make as many chapatis they could make and tell somebody to get a lot of vegetables, cook it in big quantity because I want to give to anybody who comes there. And I went to one of the hotels. From there also I purchased big pots of food and lot of bread. And when I would give it to somebody, I said to them, I'm not trying to feed you, but I'm trying to give you Baba's prasad. Because Baba never wanted anybody to go hungry. And that's how we passed the 7 days. But then Sarosh Irani thought, hey, this girl is doing so much. So he said to Erich or somebody that they would also like to contribute doing that. So one day I would do it. And one day they would do it. They would send the food. And I used to distribute in the hall. And that's how Baba's last departure time also was over. Mehra was in a very bad state. Yeah, very, very bad state. And Mani was all the time with her. Everybody was in such a shock to let Baba go. And Dr. Ram Ginde had come from Bombay. And other doctors also said that no, Baba's body should not be kept for 7 days. But from nowhere, somebody sent a big truck of ice, full of ice. And Padri Kaka ordered, there are sawmills in the village, so they got a lot of sawdust from the mills. They put a mountain of ice at the back of a tin cabin and covered it up with a lot of sawdust and gunny bags, so the ice doesn't melt fast. And every now and then they would put the fresh ice next to Baba's body to keep cool. And anyway, it was January 31st. So at that time, the climate in Nagar is very cold. And I remember the day on which beloved Baba passed away, it was full moon day. Full moon day. Meenu uncle's car did not have light. The lights did not work. So his wife would show a torch, but that torch was of no use. I said to Meenu uncle, Baba's tube light is on in the sky. Why do we need this light? Poor thing, she would feel so tired holding the torch, and Meenu would insist on having the torch. And somehow we reached Meherabad. Jai Baba. When Amrit and Dara got married, at that time we were asked to take his last darshan. And when I went in the queue to beloved Baba's feet, I bowed down and looked in his face, and Baba said to me, Roshan, I have always enjoyed the clothes that you stitched for me and the food that you cooked for me. And...
Roshan, let's start again. Do you want to start again? Dara and Amrit's wedding?
Yeah, the last day of Dara and Amrit's wedding, Baba told us to go and take his darshan. So I went in the queue, and we were not allowed to put our heads on the feet, but I just bowed down. Baba was sitting on the veranda, and we had to go in the queue. And then I looked in Baba's face, and Baba said, Roshan, I have always enjoyed the clothes that you stitched for me and the food that you cooked for me. But soon this body of mine is not going to last long. Now it's time for me to depart. I was very much touched by those words. And I said nothing, but then Baba said, but I have always enjoyed it. Like whenever the food would go from Pune to Nagar for Baba, I had a stainless steel big box in which I would put the food in, cooked food. And I would wrap it first. I would take a big piece of cloth, put the box and then lot of newspapers around on it so that the heat is kept inside the box. And then I would put it again in a big towel so that it stays still warm till it reaches Nagar. And that day Naja would also cook, thinking we never know, anything happens on the road, the food will reach very late. And she would say, Baba, the food is ready, why don't you eat? Eat that food when you feel like again. Baba said, no, she's sending me the food, I'm going to eat that food. And then Naja would try, or Mera would try to get a plate for him to take the food in it. And he said, I don't need that. He would turn the lid upside down, no spoon, because the food would be just right to eat. He would take it with his own hand in the plate and eat. And Baba would be so happy when the letter would come from Erich or Gavir that Baba enjoyed the food. I would feel so, so happy. Thanks to Baba. Thanks to Baba. He has given us the most happiest feeling in the life. Yes. One day like that, Baba asked me, do I miss Sam? Because once he would go to the ship, he would come after 3 years, 2 years. Who knows when he will come back. Baba. And he would come and stay for 2 months, 3 months and go back. So there was nothing much to feel about it. But Baba kept coming so often that kept us busy keeping things ready for Baba. Because that was rationing time. And we used to get such rubbish grains in the ration that we had to sit and clean for hours together to make it clean. And I never even thought of Sam. Only when his letter would come, I would read the letter. And it was a routine that after the household has finished reading the letter would go to Baba. And I said, Baba, I don't miss him. Really? I said, what is there to miss him? He has to go to earn money to make us live comfortably. So I don't think it is necessary. I don't know what is to miss a person. He's not there, he's not there. That time I was not able to speak in English, but I used to speak in Gujarati only. Jai Baba.